this 2 minutes, now get out of here. If you can stand against the spirit of discouragement, you have rendered the devil impotent. It has killed people more than any sickness.
Wow.
Most people in the hospitals, it's as a result of discouragement.
Wow.
When you get discouraged, all your immune system start dying.
Wow.
Discouragement. It is the greatest weapon we are facing in the body of Christ now.
Wow.
Divorce rate high is as a result of discouragement.
Wow.
Oh, these people are not ready for what I'm going to say today.
Wow.
Pastors are leaving the ministry because they are discouraged.
Right.
People are running away.
Wow.
God's principle has not changed from the natural. He tested people before he promotes them.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. His principle has not changed. Mm-hmm. One day he told me, he said, it is dangerous for me to anoint you after a certain level if I have not tested you. You must be tried to handle God's oil.
Amen.
Else it will make you proud and arrogant. You will think you did it by your own effort. Mm-hmm. You can even go and fast and think that it's because of your fasting that you are anointed.
Right.
Oh, I'm preaching. Don't stop me.
Wow.
Remember, I'm preaching the third message now. I started with faith. I came to hope. I'm trying to learn. The reason why your faith is not working is that you are discouraged.
Wow. That's so good.
The interesting thing about discouragement is that you can stand in a church and be dancing, but it's in your heart.
Wow.
You can fake it. When you are afraid, we can sense it. When you are afraid, we can see it. Pastor Paul, I don't know what is going on, but I feel that. I don't know, but there is this fear. But when you are discouraged, sometimes you don't see it. Discouragement is an egg in an incubator machine waiting for an appointed day to hatch. By the time it gets to the hatching level, there's nothing you can do about it.
Wow.
Have you seen the way all your prime ministers, their head became gray when they came to power? Discouragement. Oh, give the Lord a clap of hand. Let me don't stop me from preaching it. A man walked to my office and he said, I'm losing my potency. I said, I don't get what I say. He said, I'm losing my potency. Man of God said, Daddy, I'm losing my potency. My wife is lying down. I said, no, your potency is okay. Everything is fine. You are discouraged. I said, you are discouraged.
Wow.
There is a connection to your potency with the spirit of encouragement.
Wow.
So, it is not Satan is just telling you because, you see, I had some horses on our compound there, and I learned something very funny about them. You see, this is, let me assume, what can I use? Let's assume this is an independence pillar. There is no walls on it. If you tie the horse to this one, you know the horse cannot move. But I discovered if you take the rope and tie it to a chair, the horse will stand, thinking that the thing is tied to some pillar. So most of our stronghold is not physical, it's mental. Now, you just move the rope from the pillar and put it on a chair, and the horse thinks it is still there. And I told the guy, I said, do you know what? There's a natural thing with a man. Every man wants his family to look good. Every man wants to feed their family. Every man wants to be the head of the family. Want the wife to make sure that the family is happy. When you are not fulfilling all that, and you are going to a trial, and you don't know how to seek your God,
right,
you can be discouraged.
Right.
It's the most trusted weapon pastors are facing in this world. Discouragement. It's a major attack on pastors' wives. Discouragement. It's a major attack on pastors' children. Discouragement. Mm-hmm. What do you do when you see the people your father loves them hate him? So the major problem this generation is facing is that, oh, woman of God, if you don't take care, your children will not take the mantle you have. Discouragement. At the end of my message, I'm going to show you how to deal with it.
Amen.
Until you get the key to silent discouragement, you have no future. Because it's the beast of the devil. He put it in front of you like a mountain. When the spirit of discouragement is shot at you, it comes with a machine gun of voices. Forget about it. This thing won't work. You are already a failure. Don't even think about it. This woman doesn't love you. He thinks it's a mistake. He marries you. And it's running like a machine gun.
Wow.
Oh, the room is getting quiet. Lord, I told you that these people, they want the message like no weapon formed against you shall prosper. I don't know why you are letting me preach this. Oh, the devil knows that discouraged people cannot commune with God properly. Mm-hmm. Once he hits you with the spirit of discouragement, he cut off your frequency and ability to hear from God. Direct. He cut it off completely. Once you are discouraged, nothing works. Hallelujah. Discouraged people can stand in the center of success and still think it's a failure. Oh. Pastor Joe, you are the only one I'm preaching to. Thank God, at least. If you can get one person to hear you, you can be encouraged. I wrote something here in one of my sessions. I said that it is so easy to know the size of a person's faith by observing how much trouble it takes to discourage him. Maybe I have to say that again. I was going through something and the Lord gave me this one as a voice from him. He said, you know the reason why you are going through this? It's not that I don't love you. You are discouraged.
Yes.
And it shows the size of your faith.
Wow.
Oh, Jesus.
Wow.
We needed 1 week for this.
Wow.
It is so easy to know the size of a person's faith. It's so easy. Because faith is not in the same level. Jesus referred to some people as, why is it that you have no faith? Where is your faith?
Yeah.
Oh, you of little faith. Some people just say, I've never seen such a great faith.
Right.
So Jesus didn't refer to people. He knows that our faith is not in the same level. But it is easy to know the size of a person's faith by observing how much trouble it takes to discourage him. You just observe how much trouble it takes. So Satan knows, what can I shoot at him? That will let him stop coming to church. It's not that you were sick and we didn't visit you. You were discouraged. Most of the excuses that stop you from coming to church and stop the church and say all kinds of things, it's not the issue. There is something you are dealing with that is just what the Americans call undercover police. Give the Lord a clap of it. Don't look at me so we are preaching. That's simple. A policeman that is driving a taxi in New York, but it's a policeman. They disguise themselves. You don't know that they are police. And they are there. Discouragement. It's making married people live like roommates.
Yeah.
They are there. Not all people are married. Some people are living like roommates.
Yeah.
Recently, I discovered something. When people come to me, they are talking about marriage problems in church. The first thing I ask them is, when was the last time you had sex? I was talking to one lady, used to be a former Miss Ghana. I said, oh, I don't remember. I said, I've diagnosed the problem. Now go to laboratory and bring the text and they come and let me see what I can prescribe. There's a spiritual laboratory. This is why we don't test your blood. We test your discouragement level. We test your hopeless level. We diagnose. After that, we make prescriptions. My first prescription was to the lady was that stay out of your family and be with God for 3 days. I'll come to that in a second. That's what I'm going to close with. Today we are not going to pray. You pray in your house. Because by the time I finish preaching, you lose the power to pray. You need to gather momentum to come and pray. If you don't listen to what I'm preaching, I'm just preaching about 2% of the message. Where the word is going now, it's going to get worse.
Wow.
No, it's going to get worse.
Wow.
The Lord spoke to me, say, from now to the next 10 years, we are going to get three treacherous leaders. I'm sure one is going to come from Russia. It's a prophetic word. Putin is going to step out of power, but the one that will come will be more dangerous than him. Wow. And the Lord told me this post. What the world need now is a reviver. Yes. Yes. Listen, there is no problem with this country. Today I was driving, I was coming, I told him, I said that, I've traveled by the grace of God a few places. There's no country I go, I see better cars than Britain. Wow. Where I am living in that area, I don't know the name well, but somewhere in the central, somewhere, St. James something. The cars I see there, Rolls Royce, Bentley, that's it. This country, there's a lot of money.
Yeah.
Right.
There's a lot of money. Right. The country is not broke.
Yeah.
Whether you exit or you stay, you are not broke. It's not important. Those things are just. Now, I mean, I don't know much about those things, but God is just dealing with a lot of corruption and all kinds of crazy things. He has a way. Because sometimes you can hear the prayer of one saint and step into the matter.
Amen. That's all.
It's not that God doesn't answer our prayers, so we don't believe in our prayers. That's a problem we are facing. It's another message for another time. Hallelujah. It's not for today. No, it's not for today. It's not for today. The difference between those guys who can pray for 10 minutes. Oh, and then shake. Somebody pray a prayer, one man, and lock the word for 3.5 years. He locked the heavens. One man. Out of all the population, one man kneel down and pray and say, I've closed the heaven. Three years, 6 months, no rain. And boom, he locked it, put the key in his pocket, walking around. Yes, one prophet just locked the heavens, put the key in his pocket, walking around. And go. He himself was affected by the keys in his pocket. Going to widow's house and all kinds of things and begging for food, key in your pocket. Lock it. He came back after 3 years and opened it up. I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. Pop, 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 it was raining. One man. And this is what James says. Elijah was a man subject to life passion. It means he has constitution. He has the weakness you have. He didn't do that because he was a perfect man. If you read the Bible, God has never used perfect people. Never. Never. Oh, from Adam to, oh, God has never. The only perfect Jew that walk on this planet Earth is called Jesus Christ. Apart from that, there's never anybody. He has never used perfect people. I'm telling you, the day Abraham lied, he called him a prophet.
Yes.
He lied, he gave him a new title. The guy was called Abraham. Abimelech said, the man is a liar. He said, shut up, he's a prophet. I kept quiet. God has never used perfect people. They said, oh, Jesus Christ. David, a man after God's own heart. Go and read about him.
Yes.
Read about him. Wrote some of the powerful books. Combination of kingship and prophetic anointing. Priesthood enter everywhere, and people who work in David's palace wives are in trouble. Let me tell you something. You have to thank God. We are past. If your wife works in David's palace, if your wife goes to the saloon and come back, you better fast and pray. You are in big time trouble. Anything can happen to you at any time. God has never used perfect people. The problem is not that God doesn't want to use you. One day I was praying the Lord, God used me, say, stand up and get out of here. I don't want to hear that.
Wow.
I'm praying and say, use me. He said, no, I don't want to hear that. So what do I do? Oh, thank God. Thank God he has ability to correct things. Do you know you can pray all kinds of nonsense prayer? You don't know that the prayers are nonsense.
Yes.
He said, don't pray that. He said, pray and tell me to make you usable. Because I'm already looking for people to use. The reason I can't use you is that you are not usable. There are strengths. There are characters in you that stop me from using. Oh, give the Lord a clap of him, preaching. Oh, somebody will hear this. Oh, give the Lord a shout if you are here. And let the mountains hear your voice. Jesus. Use me and use me and use me. I say, me and you who arrive here first. I'm looking for people to use. Pray, ask me to make you usable. Deal with the strengths and the characters. The things that if I begin to use you, it will destroy you and bring disgrace to my kingdom. These are the things that you have to pray, Lord, make me usable. Don't tell me to use you because I'm waiting for you to use you. who said, I didn't want to use Moses, who was trying to kill people. He was a murderer before he became the most humble person. It took 40 years for God to develop that humility in him. I'm preaching. 40 years. Go and take care of sheep. If you can take care of sheep for 40 years, you can handle human beings. Make me usable. Can we say something for 5 minutes? Jesus Christ. Do you know what stopped the Israelites from entering the promised land? The first generation, discouragement. At Kadesh Barnea. Yeah. They saw the sons of Anak and they were discouraged.
Yes.
Discouragement will let you say things you are not supposed to say.
Yes. Wow.
Oh, I'm preaching.
Yes.
You see the way you are shouting on your wife is discouragement. It reduces the temperature of your love. It makes you do things, go back and kneel down in your pillow and say, oh, is it me? And the devil say, yes, it's you. Discouragement. We had a property in Tema that we bought, paid for. One day we came back, we've thrown our things away. I was talking to Archbishop on Friday, just exactly today's weekend. He said, Nana, do you know I thought that initially you have something to do with the thing? That you wanted to just, you play some games so that you can sell the thing? And put, I said, why, Papa? He said, because it didn't show. You didn't show anything. I came, I saw you were preaching on the street and all that. I said, this message was in my spirit. And I told him, I said, one, the devil doesn't attack anything that doesn't have a future. Do you know why there's a lot of attack and pressure on you? Because of your destiny.
Amen.
So I told him, I said, that's number one. I said, number one, that is what, and number two, one, John the Baptist church was in the bush. There was no, it has no church auditorium. And people were running to go there. Thank God for auditoriums. But if one day you come and God forbid, the roof has taken, the storm has taken everything out of heaven. Are you going to say because there's no church, you will worship God?
Right.
No. So let's always serve God with an anticipation that am I serving God because of this comfort? Well, if he takes the comfort, what happens? That was the test between Job and his wife.
Yes.
No. Are you sure you are ready for more messages?
Yes.
That's what it is. Now your husband is looking good and he's giving the money and all that, but it will be tested.
Yes.
One day the guy can go to work and come and say, I'm fired.
Right.
Right.
Okay. He can go to work and come and out of, as a result of exit, you too will exit something. Everything can exit. Everything is exiting. What are you talking about? It's very unpredictable. If you don't live by faith, you will live. Listen to me. A lot of people are living in the future now. And it's dangerous. Because yesterday is God. Today is a gift. Tomorrow is in the hands of God.
Right.
But a lot of you are living. How am I going to eat tomorrow?
Yeah.
That's why you are not paying tithe. That's why you don't give the right offerings. Do you know why you don't give the right offering? Do you know why you don't sow the seed you have to sow? You don't believe God will bring the returns.
Wow.
You don't believe that. No, you don't believe. You don't believe. When you begin to believe it, you don't need encouragement to do it.
Amen.
When Solomon sacrificed 1,000 burnt offering and God walked into his room with that prayer and said, ask me what I should do. The next time he gave 100,000. And the next one he gave seed that cannot be counted. He gave offering. Now, if I gave 1,000 and God came to my bedroom, what do you want me to give next? I gave 1,000 sheep. without prayer. People have prayed for 10 years. God has never walked into their room. I gave 1,000 sheep. God came and said, Solo, this is not prayer and answer. Ask me what I can do for you. Now, this is the interesting thing. Even when he asked for wisdom, God said, I will add riches. The next time when he went to the altar, he sent 100,000 sheep.
Wow.
Because there was an evidence of the 1,000.
Wow.
You are not listening to what I'm saying. No. You don't believe it. No. 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 I was telling our church, I said, God loves a cheerful giver. It's the lowest level of the giving. When God wants to make you a millionaire in harvest, you must go through a test. Because the road to success is more important to God than the success itself. Now let me say this. It is a suicide mission for God to bless you at a certain level when you are not giving at a certain level. To kill you completely. No. This year I have given over 8 cars as a gift. Just give it out. So I tell my wife, give it out. People give me cars, say, give it out. Just give it out. Let it go. Give it out. I gave it out. So sometimes we begin to get shortage of cars. I said, no, give it up. Because the Lord told me, he said, if I started giving to you, don't give at a certain level. The devil will direct you what to do with the money.
Wow.
Pastor Paul, that is why people's blessings get crippled in the church.
Yeah.
You see, God blessing people, they come to a place, they plateau. They come to a place, they start having problems. I even discovered that if you are not giving at a certain level, do know something. A man was going through some health problems. And we started praying for him. I said, Lord, what is it? He said, when he was broke, he made a vow to me that when I bless him, he will do this. Do you know discouragement can let you forget your vow?
Right.
And prosperity without the spirit of giving can let you forget what you told God 10 years ago. But remember, God doesn't forget. Most of the things that you said that you think that you just said it as a joke, it's in the record books of God.
Right.
Just put it down. Oh, I'm preaching. Hallelujah.
Yes.
So sometimes, be careful what you say.
Yeah.
Be careful. Be careful the vows you make. Be careful the promises that you are not fulfilling them. Lord, can you see the way they are quiet on me? Let me drink water. We don't serve, the greatest thing God told me, we don't serve. I told Papa something. Archbishop, I said, where God has brought us now, if he didn't allow the devil to lock our property, we'll never have gotten there.
That's right.
So the Lord told me, the man who was an instrumental to lock the thing, instead of cursing him, pray for him.
Wow.
Now, listen. Without Penina, Hannah wouldn't have gotten somewhere.
Yes. Yes. Wow. That's right.
It is Goliath that brought David to the limelight.
Yeah.
Yes.
Who would have known that shepherd boy?
Yes.
No. Your family even don't remember you. Who should remember you? Your father has so many children that you can forget about some of them. Bring all your children. The prophet says, let me check one. Two. Aha, there's one there. It's a shepherd bush. Bring it. No! Your father can forgotten about you in the midst of a major prophet instruction. You can see how rejected you are. God just located you. He told David, you see that your shepherd dress, hang it in a room. So that when you are becoming proud, you go and look at it. He stole so he said, when thou art little in your own eyes, I call.